A Bekkersdal Marathon by Herman Charles Bosman. Atnodi, who had a wireless set, came into Yuri Steyn's voorkamer, where we were sitting waiting for the government lorry from Bekkersdal, and gave us the latest news. He said that the newest thing in Europe was that young people there were going in for non-stop dancing. It was called marathon dancing, Atnodi told us. And those young people were trying to break the record for who could remain on their feet longest, dancing. We listened for a while to what Atnodi had to say. And then we suddenly remembered a marathon event that had taken place in the little dorp of Bekkersdal. Almost in our midst, you could say. What was more, there were quite a number of us sitting in Yuri Steyn's post office who had actually taken part in that non-stop affair. And without knowing that we were breaking records, and without expecting any sort of prize for it either. We discussed that affair at considerable length, and from all angles, and we were still talking about it when the lorry came. And we agreed that it had been, in several respects, an unusual occurrence. We also agreed that it was questionable whether we could have carried off things so successfully that day if it had not been for Billy Robertson. You see, our organist at Bekkersdal was Billy Robertson. He had once been a sailor and had come to the Bushveld some years before travelling on foot. His belongings, fastened in a red handkerchief, were slung over his shoulder on a stick. Billy Robertson was journeying in that fashion for the sake of his health. He suffered from an unfortunate complaint, for which he had, at regular intervals, to drink something out of a black bottle that he always carried handy in his jacket pocket. Billy Robertson would even keep that bottle beside him in the organist gallery, in case of a sudden attack. And if the hymn the predicant gave out had many verses, you could be sure that about halfway through, Billy Roberts would bring the bottle up to his mouth, leaning sideways towards what was in it. And he would put several extra twirls into the second part of the hymn. When he first applied for the position of organist in the Bekkersdal Church, Billy Roberts had told the meeting of deacons that he'd learnt to play the organ in a cathedral in Northern Europe. Several deacons felt then that they could not favour his application. They said that the cathedral sounded too papist. The way Billy Robertson described it, with a dome 300 foot high and with marble apostles. But it was lucky for Billy Robertson that he was able to mention, at the following combined meeting of elders and deacons, that he had also played the piano in a South American dance hall, of which the manager had been a Presbyterian. He asked the meeting to overlook his unfortunate past, saying that he'd had a hard life and that anybody could make mistakes. In any case, he had never cared much for the Romish atmosphere of the cathedral, he said, and had been happier in the dance hall. In the end, Billy Roberts got the appointment. But in his sermons for several Sundays after that, the predicant, Dominie Veldhagen, had spoken very strongly against the evils of dance halls. He described those places of awful sin in such burning words that at least one young man went to see Billy Robertson privately with a view to taking lessons in playing the piano. But Billy Robertson was a good musician, and he took a deep interest in his work, and he said that when he sat down on the organist stool behind the pulpit, and his fingers were flying over the keyboards, and he was pulling out the stops, and his feet were pressing down the notes that sent the deep bass tones through the pipes, then he felt he could play all day, he said. I don't suppose he guessed that he would one day be put to the test, however. It all happened through Dominie Veldhagen one Sunday morning going into a trance in the pulpit. And we did not realize he was in a trance. It was an illness that overtook him in a strange and sudden fashion. At each service, the predicant, after reading a passage from the Bible, would lean forward with his hand on the pulpit rail and give out the number of the hymn we had to sing. For years, his manner of conducting the service had been exactly the same. He would say, for instance,
"We will now sing Psalm 82, verses 1 to 4.
Then he would allow his head to sink forward onto his chest, and he would remain rigid, as though in prayer, until the last notes of the hymn died away in the church. Now, on that particular morning, just after he'd announced the number of the psalm, without mentioning what verses, Dominie Veldhagen again took a firm grip on the pulpit rail and allowed his head to sink forward onto his breast. We did not realize that he'd fallen into a trance of a peculiar character that kept his body standing upright while his mind went a blank. We learnt that only later. In the meantime, while the organ was playing over the opening bars, we began to realize that Dominie Veldhagen had not indicated how many verses we had to sing. But he would discover his mistake, we thought, after we'd been singing for a few minutes. All the same, one or two of the younger members of the congregation did titter slightly when they took up the hymn books. For Dominie Veldhagen had given out Psalm 119. And everybody knows that Psalm 119 has 176 verses. This was a church service that will never be forgotten in Bekkersdal. We sang the first verse, and then the second, and then the third. When we got to about the sixth verse, and the minister still gave no sign that it would be the last, we assumed that he wished us to sing the first eight verses. For if you open your hymn book, you will see that Psalm 119 is divided into sets of eight verses, each ending with the word poser. We ended the last notes of verse 8 with more than an ordinary number of turns and twirls, confident that at any moment Dominie Veldhagen would raise his head and let us know that we could sing Amen. It was when the organ started up very slowly and solemnly with the music for verse 9 that a real feeling of disquiet overcame the congregation. But of course, we gave no sign of what went on in our minds. We held Dominie Veldhagen in too much veneration. Nevertheless, I would rather not say too much about our feelings. When verse followed verse and poser succeeded poser, and still Dominie Veldhagen made no sign that we'd sung long enough, or that there was anything unusual in what he was demanding of us. After they'd recovered from their first surprise, the members of the church council conducted themselves in a most exemplary manner. Elders and deacons tiptoed up and down the aisles, whispering words of reassurance to such members of the congregation, men as well as women, who gave signs of wanting to panic. At one stage, it looked as though we were going to have trouble from the organist. That was when Billy Robertson, at the end of the 34th verse, held up his black bottle and signaled quietly to the elders to indicate that his medicine was finished. At the end of the 35th verse, he made signals of a less quiet character, and again at the end of the 36th verse. That was when Elder Lunsman towed out of the church and went around to the consistory where the Nachmal wine was kept. When Elder Lunsman came back into the church, he had a long black bottle half hidden under his mantle. He took the bottle up to the organist gallery, still walking on tiptoe. At verse 61, there was almost a breakdown. That was when a message came from the back of the organ, where Costa Clarkson and the assistant verger, whose task it was to turn the handle that kept the organ supplied with wind, were in a state near to exhaustion. So it was Deacon Cronier's turn to go tiptoeing out of the church. Deacon Cronier was head warder at the local jail. When he came back, it was with three burly native convicts in striped jerseys who also went through the church on tiptoe. They arrived just in time to take over the handle from Koster Klaassen and the assistant verger. At verse 98, the organist again started making signals about his medicine. And once more, Elder Landsman went around to the consistory. This time, he was accompanied by another elder and the deacon, and they stayed away somewhat longer than the time when Elder Landsman had gone on his own. On their return, the deacon bumped into a small hymn book table at the back of the church. Perhaps it was because the deacon was a fat, red-faced man and not used to tiptoeing. At verse 124, the organist signaled again, and the same three members of the church council filed out to the consistory, the deacon walking in front this time. It was about then that the pastor of the Full Gospel Apostolic Faith Church, about whom Dominie Veldhagen had in the past used almost as strong languages about the Pope, came up to the front gate of the church to see what was afoot. He lived near our church, and having heard the same hymn tune being played over and over for about 8 hours, he was a very amazed man. Then he saw the door of the consistory open, and two elders and a deacon coming out, walking on tiptoe, they having apparently forgotten that they were not in the church then. When the pastor saw one of the elders hiding a black bottle under his mantle, a look of understanding came over his features. The pastor walked off, shaking his head. At verse 152, the organist signaled again. This time, Elder Landsman and the other elder went out alone. The deacon stayed behind in the deacon's bench, apparently in deep thought. The organist signaled again for the last time at verse 169. So you can imagine how many visits the two elders made to the consistory all together. The last verse came, and the last line of the last verse. This time it had to be Amen. Nothing could stop it. I would rather not describe the state that the congregation was in. And by then, the three native convicts, red stripes and all, were, in the Bakatla tongue, threatening mutiny. Amen! Came from what sounded like less than a score of voices hoarse with singing. The organ music ceased. Maybe it was the sudden silence that at last brought Dominie Veldhagen out of his long trance. He raised his head and looked slowly about him. His gaze travelled over his congregation, and then, looking at the windows, he saw that it was night. We understood right away what was going on in Dominie Veldhagen's mind. He thought he had just come into the pulpit and that this was the beginning of the evening service. We realized that during all the time we'd been singing, the predicant had been in a state of unconsciousness. Once again, Dominie Veldhagen took a firm grip on the pulpit rail. His head again started drooping forward onto his breast. But before he went into a trance for the second time, he gave the hymn for the evening service.
We will, Dominie Veldhagen announced, sing Psalm 119.